Thank you so, so much. It is wonderful to be here. We have all, as drummers, been waiting for this for a long time. I talked to a few people today that had tickets from 2020. So for us to be here today is just incredible. And to get to see the people that are playing and be in a room and feel the air just moving instead of watching it on your phone, it's so cool. We're all here tonight. Not for Eddie, not for Annika, not for Eric, Carter, Ash, Virgil, we're here for this instrument that we all love, that we all practice every day, and we try so, so hard to make it sound good and to have something to say on this instrument. And that's what tonight is going to be about. Of course, I'm going to play some drums, but tonight is really about finding your voice on this instrument. And if we all have access to the same information, do you play drums, sir? What is a paradiddle? And you crushed it. Now, he mumbled it a little bit, but he said it solid. Right, left. Eddie has taught me that people in the UK tend to mumble a little bit because we were making phone calls in the first place. You all right, mate? And then they just hang up, and I was like, what the hell did he say? And Eddie's like, oh, he said he'd meet us at noon. When did that happen? So anyways, right, left. We all have access to the same information. I don't have a secret book of rudiments that I'm like hiding and only Eddie and I look at it. We're like, oh, don't tell anybody about this on the podcast. We have access to the same information. We have access to the same music. We can all listen to whatever music we want. We have access to the same type of gear. We have drums, we have snares, we have cymbals. Yet each one of us sounds so uniquely different on this instrument. So I want to ask you a quick question, real quick. I just need a show of hands. Solid click. How many people here feel like they can play this groove? How many people here feel like they can play that? Keep your hands up. Do not put your hand down just because I turned my back on you. Okay. White sweatshirt, come on up. Black sweatshirt with white, or black t-shirt with white writing and decent biceps. Yep, you. Beard. You right there. Yep. Decent, flowy, curly hair. Yep. Come on up. Oh, hands down. I just needed three. I'm sorry. Yeah, come on up and then just do the best you can to not make a fool out of yourself jumping onto the stage, because this will live forever on Instagram, YouTube, everywhere. Okay, so we'll start with you. How old are you? 15, and you just straight raised your hand like it was no big deal. I can do it. I'm Mike. Nice to meet you, brother. Okay, you've got your own sticks. Go ahead and play that groove for us. And to everyone here, you guys can add any bass drum notes, any ghost notes, whatever you want. You don't have to copy me.
Woo! Come on. Hey! Oh!
I didn't say anything about fills. Why are you dropping heat? Great job, man. Great job. You can stay up here. Great job. No. Stay up here. Yeah. Of course. Sorry about that. Okay, try to remember what it sounded like when he played that groove. Once again, your own bass drum pattern. If you want ghost notes, that's a Windows PC. Macs don't do that. Go ahead. Oh. Okay. Come on. Hey! Yeah. I'll take it. Beautiful. That was great. Awesome job. No. You come on up here. Amazing job. What's your name?
Nicholas.
I'm Mike. Nice to meet you. And you are?
I was actually messaging you on Instagram from
Ireland. Oh, yeah. Hi. Well, it's good to have you up on the stage, Andy. Oh, goodness gracious. Okay, now try to keep that in mind, what you just heard, that groove, that feel, that touch. Yep. And if you don't want to do what I said and you just want to rip a 10-minute solo, go for it. Coming in hot. Hey! Yeah, you want that Instagram stuff. I can feel that. Okay. In 1, 2, oh, 3, 4. Yes. Beautiful. Great job. Thank you. Come on down. That's all I needed. Thank you, brother. Awesome. Yeah, man. Good to see you. Absolutely crushed it. Great job. Well done, my friend. Hey, tell me about your heartbeat. How was it? Was it a little elevated?
Unstable.
Unstable. Okay, that's great. I've heard that's really good for a heart, for it just to be irregular. So hopefully some of you put yourselves in that position and thought, oh my God, what if that was me? How would you feel right now? Would all of your facility just fall apart and things that you've always been able to do at home not work? That stuff, I'm not judging that. I know exactly how intimidating that moment can be. All I was listening for was, it's the same beat, it's the same kit, in the same room, all played by three different people, and that beat never once sounded remotely the same because those three drummers have a voice. They have a very specific voice. And we think about like, oh, I gotta learn more difficult stuff and I gotta be more complicated and all that. And it's like, well, you don't. What you need is a voice. Why would I ever hire Ash Stone over Steve Jordan? I got a pop gig coming up. I've got two drummers to choose from, Ash Stone or Steve Jordan. The answer to that question is just yes. The answer is always yes. If you have Ash and Steve, you're fine. Well, I would hire that one of them because of their voice. It'd be like, I think Ash would be perfect for this track. I think Steve would be perfect for that track. I think Matt Chamberlain would be perfect for this track. You know what? This one's a little heavier. Let's bring in Eddie Thrower. It's the voice. At no point are these people thinking, who's the best? Like, he plays later. His name's Virgil Donati. He's the best. He wins. Okay, so, but it's not about that. Like, why would I hire Virgil over someone else in that world? For his voice. And so we have to figure out, well, how do you practice having a voice? And the reason why it's so important for me to talk about this today is because that's all I've been doing for the last 5 years, is trying to develop my voice. As an educator, I've always just done, my voice was determined by either the band or the chart or the book I was playing out of, but I had no voice. I didn't even know how I liked to tune my drums or what kind of cymbals I liked. It was like, I don't know, I just got expensive drums and expensive cymbals and I learned the chart and that was that. But then at some point it's like, well, who's Mike Johnston as a player? So I started working on my voice, and I'm here to tell you that that is deep into the journey. In the beginning, your voice is actually created by your idols, the things that you listen to, the people you look up to. That's where your voice shows up. So check this out. I'm going to show you exactly where a lot of my voice comes from, but I'm going to reference the actual influence itself so you can kind of hear it. So, that's a solid click. So let's say one thing that's in my voice a lot is a five-stroke roll between floor tom, bass drum, and snare. So this phrasing of right, right, left, left, right, I play that all the time, but as right, right, kick, kick, snare. So when you hear me do this, itself, where does that come from? Well, it didn't come from me. It came from this right here. I hope some of you are over 30. That little five-stroke roll thing, for me, it's not a five-stroke roll the way Tim Alexander was playing it in Primus, but I didn't have a double bass pedal to approximate that sound. So I just thought, well, it's not enough to just do a little double bass or single foot flutter. So I added in the floor tom, and that became... So... when you hear me do that on a modern Instagram, YouTube video or something, that's, you know, from 1994. It's from Primus. Another thing that you'll hear me do a lot in my playing is these nine-stroke roll variations. So our normal phrasing for that, right, right, left, left, right, right, left, left, right. I just started thinking, like, well, really, what makes it what it is? It's nine notes long, and it usually ends on the snare. Well, what if I just messed around with the eight notes leading up to the snare? I wish I could say that was my thought process. I got that thought process from this, I don't know if you would call it djent or metal or modern metal, but check this out. It's djent, right? Yeah, yeah. And this is Animals as Leaders. Here in this love together, and like berries on the vine, it gets sweeter all the time. All right. Now just listen up. Game changer. Come on! That was on the radio in America. And the producer was like, yeah, yeah, it's cool, Steve Gadd. We'll let it slide. All of us would have been fired for that. But when you bring in Dr. Gadd, I mean, one more time, just so you can appreciate what happened in 1982 on an Al Jarreau record. Oh, come on. Ooh. So, I mean, first of all, when you drove here today, do you think you'd be sitting in a room with a bunch of drummers listening to a love song? No, but you are, and it's awesome. Hey, where's that cymbal at? How far did it make it back? Where is it? Oh, cool, third row. This'll totally work out great for me. That'll definitely make it to the back by the end. Keep passing it around. Okay, so that little thing, that nine-stroke roll variation where I thought, wait a minute, that was the phrasing of... But Steve said, nay, nay. I got more sauce than that producer. And the producer was like, I don't know, you're more famous than me, so go for it. So I started thinking about things like that, like, well, what else could, what could I do? What about, I don't know. That's nine notes. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. Cool. I'm gonna work my ass off on that nonstop until it becomes replaceable for the nine-stroke roll. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. Great, I'm happy. What about... I don't know. That's cool. I like that. Yeah, pure spicy meatballs. Inverted double strokes. Great. Now I've got two inverted nine-stroke rolls. Give me a third. How about inverted double strokes between kick and floor tom? All right, so let's see if we can put all that together. That's from Al Jarreau, right? I mean, that... From the 1980s and, like, pink shirts with white pants all the way to Instagram gold? Come on. That's part of your voice. The other thing that I think people have in their voice is their mannerisms, the way they look when they play drums. You know, watching Eric play this morning, I've known Eric since we were kids, and just... Some of the things that Eric does, like when he bites his bottom lip, and I'm like, oh, the sauce is about to happen. Because Eric can play some of the most complicated things on the planet without breaking a sweat. So if he's gonna bite his bottom lip, you better get your phone out. And then watching Eddie play, you know, like the way that he would like brush the hi-hat right and left, like, you know, like he watched Karate Kid too many times or something. And I was like, oh, this is awesome. He just wax on, wax off. But it was like, It's his thing. He doesn't have to do it, but it's one of his things. Bang, guitar, 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 guitar. So I was watching him from backstage and just thinking like, oh, that's so cool. And because it's an Eddie-ism, you got to leave it alone. Because as soon as I do it, somebody's like, oh, cool. You big fan of Eddie Thrower? No, I'm not a big fan. You're weird. I'm not a big fan of anybody. You know, I have those isms in my playing that are not just audible, but they're visual. When I was really young, I watched this, like, Legends of Jazz Drumming DVD. Well, I'll be honest with you, it was a videotape because I'm kind of old. But I watched this videotape, and I remember I was watching this section of Sonny Payne. And Sonny Payne, if you don't know, was just not only one of the greatest drummers to ever live, but he was one of the greatest showmen to ever live. And he was playing this gorgeous little buzz roll. And I remember, like, as he's playing it, he smiles at the buzz roll, but like the buzz roll knew something that we didn't know. So he was going. He did that. And I was like, what did the buzz roll tell you? What did the buzz roll tell you? I was 8 years old. I thought there was some magic communication going on. Just one more time. Oh. And then years later, I saw this Genesis DVD. Or no, it was actually Phil Collins, not Genesis. Phil Collins, the tour was called But Seriously Live. And Phil does a Phil with an F. Phil does a Phil. And he goes, sha-doom, ga-doom, ding, flap-a-da-da-doom. Hits his crash with his head this way and then smiles at his crash. And he was like, and I thought, did it surprise you, Phil? Did it do something you didn't think it was going to do? At what point did that crash cymbal do something that you weren't prepared for? But it kind of surprised. He was like, man, that's a good sounding crash cymbal. I think it was 1980 something. I think it was a 20-inch Meinl extra hammered thin crash. I'm pretty sure that was what Phil was playing at the time. But so you'll see that in my playing when I play a little bit later. You'll see in my playing that I smile at my gear, not when it surprises me, but when it does exactly what I thought it would do. I'm just going to chalk that one up to jet lag. When it does exactly what I thought it was going to do, because I am singing everything in my head, and so right before it happens, I've already sung it, and then when it does it, you know, before I ever hit this, if you guys could get a microphone in my head, you would always hear, boosh. I always go, boosh. And then when I hit it and it goes, boosh, I'm like, damn right. And then, you know, like, my cross stick, it's supposed to sound like Vinnie Caliuta, you know, when Vinnie would do a cross stick, it sounded like a sample of the gods. Like he had a deal with not God himself, but like the drum gods. You know, there's like six of them up there. And they just sent him the sample of cross stick. And so every time I hit a cross stick and it gets it just right, I'm like, you little biscuit. You did exactly what I wanted you to do. So all those things start to make up my voice. But so far, every ounce of my voice has been made up of other people. So we've got Steve Gadd playing with Al Jarreau. We've got, you know, Tim Alexander from Primus. There's also a ton. I grew up in the same town as the Deftones, so there's a lot of Abe Cunningham in my playing because we were just kids playing drums together. And then I also grew up playing big band, so there's a lot of kind of jazz improvisation. I've just straightened it out, but it's still there. So all that stuff is part of my voice, but it's all part of the past. When you've decided, okay, I know what my drumming DNA is. I know who the drummers that I've looked up to are. I've brought in the things I love about their playing into my playing. At some point, you have to say, all right, well, who are you? And that's where we start this journey. So for me, I just want to show you one element of my voice and how I practiced it, and then maybe you can just take that process and move it on to yourself in any way you want. So one thing that I really wanted to be a big part of my voice was left foot, this sound right here. That texture. Oh. I mean, if you guys don't have the 15-inch Foundry Reserve hats, I don't care. You can have a ton of different companies, but just get these and you'll be fine for the rest of your life. That sound, you know, I wanted that to be in my drumming. So let's talk about the role of the left foot. I think a lot of people, I hear them say, well, it's the timekeeper. Really? What if you have bad time? Is it still the timekeeper? It sounds like it's having a seizure. So I don't think this is the timekeeper at all. We are the timekeepers. If I have bad time, this will sound bad. If I have good time, this will sound good. So to me, this isn't the timekeeper. This is the conveyor of the pulse. This is showing the world what I believe the pulse to be. Once again, if I don't have good time, it's not going to sound good. And if I do have good time, it will sound good. But it's not a timekeeper. It's just a way to show the audience, show my bandmates the pulse. So if I'm playing something a little abstract, it's the conveyor of the pulse. You don't have to clap for that one. I appreciate it, but I'll make it obvious when I think something should be clapped for. Like, I'll just look down until I hear it. But if I look right up, you don't have to clap. But if I look down, that's me going like, come on, people, clap. That was freaking amazing, and you know it was, so I'd appreciate a little bit of applause. So that thing, I'm showing you where the pulse is. So that's one of its roles. The other role that I think we ignore sometimes is that this can be an energy changer. So if I have a groove like this, raise your hands if you can play that. I won't call you up here to play. Most people here can play that, right? Okay, cool. So how do we change the energy of that if somebody says, no, that is the groove. I do not want you to change the groove. But maybe just can you just make it like kind of drive a little more? It's like, okay, quarter notes. Kind of sounds the same. What if somebody said, no, it's not that. I need it to like have more life to it. Can you make it happier? Oh, can I make the groove happier, Mr. Producer? Yeah, of course. Let me sprinkle some freaking happy dust on it. What do you mean make it happier? Well, think about it. Where does happiness live? Happiness lives on the upbeats. All music that's based around joy and happiness lives on the upbeats. Think if reggae was played on the downbeats. Oh my God. Could you imagine? Like, oh, yeah, man. It's not happy anymore. Someone stole the happiness because the happiness lives on the upbeats. So if I was here, and somebody said, can you make it happier? Sure, with the left foot. Oh my God, come on. So the happiness can be there if you have the independence, if you've worked out the independence. What if somebody says, I just need it to push? And what drummers normally do is we speed up. And they're like, no, don't speed up. I just need it to push. And we're like, I appreciate your role as the musical director of this church, but what the fuck do you mean you want it to push and you don't want it to be faster? That doesn't make it. So it's like, well, what you can do is you can double the subdivisions. If the people that are listening to you hear twice as many notes, that measure becomes more condensed and it has more notes in it. So if I needed to make this push, and they said, yeah, push that, but never speed up. Like, okay. And then they're like, oh yeah, that, can you just do that? And I'm like, well, could you just learn to say, can you play eighth notes with your left foot? Because that would make this so much easier instead of using words like, it's a Latin funk thing. No, it's not. There are no Latin funk things. What is it? Is it Latin or is it funk? By the way, there are Latin funk things, but that's always a confusing one too. So now, if we have that, let's listen to the three different moods that provides between quarter note, upbeat, and eighth note. So it's my job as a drummer to be a chameleon and be ready to say, like, yeah, I can change the mood of any groove through my left foot. So that's one of the left foot's roles. And the third and final role that we're going to talk about today that I think is the most important role that this thing provides, especially for me, is texture. There is a sound that this makes that I can't recreate without doing that. This doesn't sound the same. Tip of the stick, top of the hat, doesn't sound the same. The bell, which no one's ever hit, doesn't sound the same. Some people do hit the bell. Open, not the same. This is its own thing. This is the Samwise Gamgee of texture. Yeah, Frodo got all the credit, just like flams and drags. But Frodo never would have made it to that mountain without Sam. Y'all be forgetting about this left foot. This is the Samwise Gamgee of texture. So start to work on bringing that into your drumming. You know, if we had this groove here, or anything kind of slightly syncopated like that, bringing that left foot in changes everything. Just that little note, but how do you do that without this? Because that's what we don't want. We want this in there. But I don't want this. You know, you don't want to like lift your whole body up to use that. So the exercise that I worked on for way too long and way too much of my life was just to play a Gadsden groove like the three guys that came up here earlier. So I'd play that groove, but I was doing it with eighth notes on my right hand, and then the E's and U's with my left foot. Now there's a decent chance that this entire stage is gonna fall over while I'm doing this, but it'll make for a good little clip. My laptop is literally laughing at me. Doing that without any opens, so incredibly difficult. So if you want to take one thing home from this weekend to practice, try playing that, just a basic 16th note groove, but left foot is on the E's and U's. You have one E and a, two E and a, three E and a, four E and a. Just get that bass drum going. So I usually will grid the bass drum. That is a nightmare. Yeah, you should clap. Sorry, thank you. I don't feel like 10 minutes more. I'm kind of on a roll, bro, so thank you. I appreciate it. Okay, so real quick, before I play my last track, I do have I have time for one question, unless my answer is short, which has never happened. So raise your hand if you have a question in 3, 2, don't do this. Come on. Yeah, I'll take it. Thank you. Thanks for saving me, bro. Yeah. Sure. Sure. Yeah. For everybody in the back, I'm not going to repeat the question. I want you to guess his question based off my answer. So when you encounter a hippopotamus, what you want to do is... he was asking how to develop, you know, up-tempo, whether it's swing or just up-tempo ride cymbal patterns, ding-chicka-ding-chicka-ding-ding-ding-ding-ding-ding-ding-ding, that kind of stuff. For me, it was honestly chasing songs that I physically couldn't play. I remember Harry Connick Jr. put out this song called Just Kiss Me on the Blue Light, Red Light album, and it was burning. I remember my boss metronome being like, sorry, we can't go that fast. And I had to put it in halftime, you know, but it was like, ding, chicka, ding, chicka, ding, chicka, ding, chicka, ding, 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 ding. And so it was literally me saying, how far can I get into this song? And I would get maybe 10 seconds in and then my hand would fall apart. And then the next year I'd get 30 seconds in. Then one day I made it to the second chorus and it was just chasing that. There was also Mike Stern tune, I can't remember the name of it, but Vinnie Caliuta played on it, and it was burning on the hi-hat, like, stuck-its, and I was just like, oh my God, I want to play this. So for me, it was chasing songs. I was chasing these songs that were, I call it the desired result technique. There was a desired result that I wanted to achieve, and I just did whatever it took to get there, and then my technique developed because of me chasing those things. At some point, your wrist says, dog, it ain't gonna happen. And the fingers are like, no, use us. We can do it. We can do it. I'm like, all right, fingers, come on up. And the fingers are like, shaka-ding, 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 shaka-ding. I'm like, oh my God, this is so cool. But no, I never had like technique lessons to teach me that. I just was chasing songs that I couldn't quite get to. We have time for one more question in 3, 2. Yeah. The one rudiment. Yeah. I know that Eddie loves the six-stroke roll. Honestly, it's trash. It is a terrible rudiment. It ruins your feet. No. So it would be the same. It'd be the six-stroke roll, but for me, it's just the sticking variation of it, so the paradiddle-diddle. The paradiddle-diddle was the first rudiment I ever encountered that from the book straight to the kit, it sounded good. You know what I mean? By the way, wherever the cymbal is, since I'm running out of time, can you bring it up to the top? Helen, you sign it and bring it up here. Of course it's you, Helen. By the way, you are Helen, right? All I see is blue hair and glasses, so I'm like, that's gotta be Helen. She lives in the UK, we're in the UK, it's gotta be Helen. It's the only person I know in the UK. So yeah, for me it was the paradiddle-diddle because I could make a groove out of it, I could make a fill out of it, I could play it over ostinatos, and I didn't have to adapt it. When I learned the book report, you know, hybrid rudiments, I was like, well, damn, how am I gonna use this? Or even flam accents. I couldn't make them sound cool. Swiss triplets, I couldn't make them sound cool. But the paradiddle-diddle took no work. Just threw it on the kit. It's like that top ramen. Just put water in it, you know? It's like the recipe for tea. Put leaves in hot water, give to me. Thank you, we're done. That's the recipe. So yeah, the paradiddle-diddle for sure. Helen, are you writing a story? I am literally running out of time. You're the best. Good to see you. Thank you, dear. Oh my God, look at that. That is incredible. All right. Thank you for doing this. Look at this. How cool is that? That's amazing. That is so cool. Wow. I mean, this is just amazing. Who's Dylan Vevins? Is that a person? What? Nevins. Dylan Nevins? Yeah. Do you have a transition ride? Nope. You do now. Come on up, man. This is for you, buddy. Come on. Stop clapping or I'll start crying, you freaks. I'm gonna hide back here for a second. Okay. We're all doing the same thing. All of us. Everyone in here wants to be better at this frustrating instrument. That's what signing that symbol is about. That's what giving it to someone I've never met is about. It's just about us realizing it's not pros and amateurs and, you know, idols and all that. It's just people that want to play drums. I've said this in almost every clinic, but there's the day you start and there's Buddy Rich, and everyone in this room is somewhere in between. And that's the timeline of drumming. We all wish we were better. We're all trying. It's a frustrating, lonely instrument. Every time you finally get the fill right, no one runs into the room and it's like, yo, you got it. Nothing happens. You finally get it, and then you're like, okay, on to page 6, you know? And that's what everyone in this room shares, and we're all part of this. So thank you guys for making this such a memorable event. I'm gonna play one song that was written for me for my voice by my teacher, Will Kennedy. Last time I did a clinic with him, he said, man, your playing's come along. I'm so proud of you, but you don't have any tracks that let you be you and show your voice. Can I write you a song? And when Will Kennedy says, can I write you a song? You know, that's Ash Sohn or Steve Jordan. The answer is yes. So this is a song by Will Kennedy that he wrote so that I could show you my voice. So thank you guys for everything. I love you all, and I really appreciate it, and I can't wait to see you guys later today and tomorrow. Thank you. Thank you.